And so it was Romans chapter 1 and verse 16. It says, Paul's writing to the church in Romans. He said, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith." Now I want to take 5 minutes or so just to recap what I spoke on the last time, to set a foundation, a context, and then we're going to take it a stage further. And so it said again, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel for it's the power of God unto salvation." And so we began to ask the question, my goodness, why would Paul begin to say, "I am not ashamed of the gospel"? It seemed a very strange words to use for a minister to say, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel." But yet when we studied it and we looked at this, we began to see the passion that Paul had, the eagerness that he had to get to the church of Rome. He had traveled all around to different churches, but at this time he hasn't had an opportunity to speak to the church in Rome. And he says, "I've got to get to you." And we saw it in verse 15. He says, "I'm eager to preach" what? "I'm eager to preach the gospel to you." And we began to study this and see that actually Paul was speaking to a lot of the churches, the true gospel, or the full gospel, or the complete gospel of Jesus Christ. But a lot of churches in that day then, when he began to go away, they began not to turn their back on God, but they began to dilute the gospel. They preached, they went away from being saved by faith, and they were beginning to return back to works and the law and things like that. And so they began to take the gospel and they begin to make it a much smaller gospel. And Paul said, "I need to come to you, church, and I need to remind you again what the full gospel of Jesus is, that you would have a revelation and a full understanding of everything that Jesus has done." And why was that important? We said this because it was the power of God unto salvation. And we began to understand what that word salvation meant. So for many of us, the word salvation, we had a narrow view of it. Salvation for us meant simply that our sins are forgiven. And that is wonderful, amen. Without our sins being forgiven, we couldn't have relationship with Daddy. But that is an incomplete, or it's not the full picture. Salvation goes above and beyond our sins forgiven. And we learned the word, I should ask you so you remember. No, but I'll not do that, not embarrass you or embarrass me. So the Greek word for salvation was soterios, or a smaller word, the verb was S-O-Z-O, sozo. Easy to remember, sozo. Salvation, but it meant that you were saved, delivered, and healed. In other words, we understood that we are three parts, spirit, soul, and body. And when Jesus paid the price, and when salvation was won, and you were born again, you were delivered, spirit, soul, and body. Amen? That meant your spirit was born again. 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells us, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. In other words, the sin nature, the spirit that you had before, was taken away and put inside of you was the Spirit of God. Amen. That should blow your mind. The Spirit of God put inside of you, and you were declared the righteousness of God in your spirit, man. Then you were delivered in your soul. Your mind, your soul is your mind, your will, your intellect, your emotions. The Bible says that you have been set free, you've been delivered in that. And as you read your word, it renews your mind, and you can have that salvation. But the sword sozo also meant to be made whole, to be made complete, or to be made well. Not being made well, but you have been made well. That meant that you were healed in your body. And so Paul was desperate to get to the church in Rome to say to them, you're here thinking a small picture of what God has done. And you're trying to do works, and you're trying to do all of these things to get God's approval, when God, out of his grace and his mercy, has already accomplished everything. He has already won and lifted you from a place of defeat and put you to a place of victory. And he didn't want them to be wasting time trying to get something that God has already given. He said, now your mission and your goal is to claim and take a hold of everything that Jesus has already won for you. And we learned then that the gospel was the good news, amen. I am a preacher that will always preach the good news. The good news is that Daddy loves you. Amen. Irrespective of your actions, he still wants us to live right. But irrespective of our actions, Daddy loves everyone. Daddy is not out to get you. Amen. He's not out to punish you. He's not out to give you sickness. He's not out to rob from you. But God is a God who will bless you above all that you could ever ask or think. Amen. God is a God who has healed and has already healed you and will set you free in your body. Amen. And so we took 40 minutes. Neil, why didn't you preach that quick last time? There we go. 5 minutes of what we took, 35, 40 minutes to speak. And so I want to continue this on this morning for a short time this morning and where we got to the last time. Living the gospel. That's the message that I've come to say to you this morning. I want us to be a church. I want me to be a pastor, and I want you to be believers who live out the full gospel of Jesus Christ, amen, that don't live a defeated life, who are not living just a half measure of what God has for us, but this would be a vibrant church that fully believes in God, who believes in the finished work of Calvary, and who refuses to sit down and to allow the enemy to wreck, kill, and to steal. When we hear a report of someone that's vomiting out blood, our first thoughts are not, isn't that horrific? But our first thought is that our God is well able. And that is nothing compared to what my God can do. If God could raise Lazarus from the dead, then let me tell you, there is no sickness, no disease. There's nothing that we can face in this life that God cannot deal with. Amen. And I want this to be a believing, expecting faith church. I want this to be a spirit-filled church that says, I trust in my God, and my God is well able. Now, you're going to have to get a little bit excited with me, or I'll have to shout louder. Amen. But this is going to be a gospel-believing church. Now, I'm saying that as if we're not. We already are. But I want to take us to another level, not because that's my thoughts, but because Daddy's meeting with me every day and saying, we've got to go more. We've got to go deeper. Why? Because look at our community. Look at the church this morning. There shouldn't be an empty seat in any church. We should be trying to say, well, we're going to have to knock down that wall because there's people thing. And you would say, well, Neil, that's not the way it's going to be anymore. That was the early church. It's not today. Jesus came. He sent his word. And his word says that he doesn't wish that any should perish. And so until we're called back to him, then our mission and our goal is to preach the gospel in our nation. Amen. To declare the goodness of our God, for it is the power of God unto salvation. And so let's start off with that first sentence. It said, for I am not ashamed of the gospel. Now, if I was to ask you this morning and say, how many of us are ashamed of the gospel? I'm not sure I get many people putting up their hands. And that's fine. I didn't expect you to put up your hand this morning, because when we think of the word ashamed, we have this understanding. Ashamed means to feel guilty about something that you've done wrong. Ever done something wrong in your life? Hope nobody will find out. You try to cover it up. Or if somebody finds out, then we feel that guilt. We feel the shame of something that we've done wrong. And so when we think of that word ashamed, that's what we're associating it with. We think guilt. And so none of us would put up our hand and say, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I know everyone in here that if you were in your workplace or in school or someone says to you, are you a born-again believer? We'd all say, yes, I'm a born-again believer. Some of us would be very bold. Some of us would be timid in how we respond to that. But each of us would say, yes, I believe in God. I'm a Christian. I go to church. I believe in healing. And would say all those things. So we're not ashamed of the gospel in that context. But the word ashamed has another meaning. The word ashamed has a deeper meaning than what we understand in English. And the other meaning is this, that we are reluctant to do something because of the fear of being embarrassed. You're reluctant to do something for the fear of being embarrassed. And when Paul was speaking to the church, he said, you know what? I am not reluctant. Wherever I go, whoever I meet, I am not reluctant. I will declare the goodness of God. I will speak to them. I will lay hands on the sick, and I will expect them to recover. Now, I'm looking at myself this morning, somehow. I don't know how I'm doing that, but I'm pointing at myself anyway this morning as well. There are times in our lives, and there's many times and opportunities in work where someone comes to me and they're speaking about problems and difficulties. And well, because you're not allowed to talk about God and work and you'd lose your job, sometimes you're a bit nervous about that. Or sometimes someone's speaking about a big situation and you give these words of sympathy and empathy, and that's nice. But as a born-again believer, knowing in the power of God and knowing no matter how difficult it is, every single opportunity, we should not be reluctant to say, I hear what you've said. I see how difficult that is. But let me tell you this. Let me introduce you to Daddy, who is well able. Never being reluctant to the gospel. Never being reluctant to share what God is doing and what God can do in someone's life. I want us to be at that place that every opportunity we take it, not ashamed of the gospel, but laying hands on the sick. And it's like we enter into this continuous cycle. And here it is at the start of the cycle. We don't believe. There's the word. The word says that everybody will be at sick, but we don't really believe the word. And so what happens when we don't believe? The cycle comes to here at the bottom. We don't see the results. We don't see the healings. We don't see the deliverance. We don't see people getting blessed. We don't see the things getting turned around. And because we don't see the results, the cycle then continues in this loop that says, it didn't happen, so I don't believe. I don't believe, so I don't see results. I don't see results, so I don't believe. And the enemy comes to say to us, why would you pray for that person? Sure, you heard about Sadie. You prayed for Sadie, and she didn't get healed. You did this, and it didn't work out. And you're going to get embarrassed, and things aren't going to work out. And so the enemy comes to pull us down until we're not ashamed, but we are reluctant to share the gospel. But I want us to get to a place where the word of God is truth. Amen? That the word of God is the truth. I'm an accountant, yeah? And so when you get to meet with me, I am a very logical person. And Joanna hates having an argument with me because I am going to go A, B, C, D. That's what the teacher said to me. You should have been a lawyer. You can't win an argument. I just pointed out there, you're not going to win an argument with me. I'll change my mind in the middle of an argument just to make sure I win that argument. And so you have all of these things, and we're laid out, and we're trying to think and work this all out. I've lost my train of thought. I don't know why, what I'm talking about now. Anyway, that doesn't matter. So move on. So we have all these cycles. We're in our doubt, and we're not believing. And so there's a difference between truth. That's where I'm back now. Thank you, Father. There's a difference between truth and facts. The fact is, somebody that you know is sick. The fact is that they're vomiting, or they've got a fever. Something's going on in their body. The fact is that they haven't got money. They can't pay their bills. Those are a fact. But how many knows that facts can be interpreted in different ways? You can take a fact and look at it at a different angle and have a different story. But you cannot change truth. Truth is something. It doesn't matter what angle that you look at it from. It doesn't change. It can't be changed. That is a truth. And this is what I want our church to understand. The people are sick, yes, fact. Things are going wrong in people's lives, fact. Enemy comes in and attack, fact. But this is not a fact. This is truth. And I don't care what angle that you look at this from, you will not find a verse in here that says, and God didn't want to heal them, God didn't want to set them free, God couldn't do something. No, this Bible says that he laid hands on the sick and they recovered. It said that they were blessed in the city and blessed in the field. And too many times we take our Bible and we read what the Bible says, and then we look at experiences in our lives, and when we believe the experience of our lives and we don't believe the truth. This is a church that's going to change, and this is a church that's going to say, I don't deny the experience, but my experience is wrong. This is the truth. This is how I'm supposed to live. This is the way my life is supposed to be. This is the way that when the believer lays hands on the sick, they do recover every single time. And so until I see that happening every single time, my experience is wrong. I'm going to change my experience, and I'm going to hold on to the truth. Amen. I'm holding on to the truth. And that will get us to the place where we are not reluctant or ashamed of the gospel, but we will run to everyone and declare the greatness and of our God, that He is our healer, He's your healer, He's everyone's healer, He's everyone's savior, He's everyone's deliverer. Amen. Amen. You get that word this morning. And we are not ashamed of the gospel. We are not ashamed of the gospel. And yet our churches today, I spend so many time in work talking to Christian brothers and sisters, and Lord, they're saved, and I love them, but they don't believe in healing. They don't believe it's God's will to heal anymore. That's gone. And what a sad place it is when the body of Christ does not believe the full gospel of Jesus. We in this church believe that He is a good God, amen? That He's a miracle-working God. That He still is a miracle-working God. That He is the healer. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. It is the church that has changed and not God. He is the truth, amen? He is the way, the truth, and the life. And it's time to get back of holding on to the truth and changing our lives and our experiences. But I want to show you quickly this morning about the early church. And the early church, what they began to do and to encourage us. So let's turn this morning to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, I think it's verse 42. And they devoted themselves. So who is they in this teaching? This is those, it's not the apostle, it's not the disciples, it's the you and I, the born-again believers, the every man and woman on the street. And it says that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. In other words, they devoted themselves to the Word of God, and they had fellowship, breaking of bread, and they had prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. And all who believed, not just the apostles, but this is the church, everyone who believed, they were together, they had all things in common. They were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as they had need. And day by day, it says, they attended the temple together, breaking bread in their homes. They received their food with gladness and generous hearts, praising God, having favor with all people. And this last part says, and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Here's an example of the early church. It says at the concludes, it says, whatever they were doing, the Lord was adding to them daily. Every single day, people were getting born again. Amen. That means in a bad year, only 365 people got born again and joined the church. That's a bad year, because you could have had hundreds, thousands getting born a day. But it says every single day the Lord added to a church 365 and a quarter. I don't know who the quarter person was. But anyway, so 365 new people being born again and coming into the church. That is the heart of the Father, amen, that none should perish, that none should fall away, but all will come. Well, how did they begin to do this? Because I read it here. They got in the Word. They fellowshiped together, they prayed together, and they went out. It says that daily they went to the temple, but they didn't just go to church. It then says, and then they went house to house, and they began to talk about God. In other words, they came in on a Sunday, they got the Word of God, they got revived in the Spirit, they got healed in their own lives, they got set free, and then they left the door and they went on a mission field. Every single person that sat on a pew left that door and went into the streets, and they found someone and they talked about the goodness of God. That is how the early church began to operate. They came into the temple, but then they left and they went into a mission field. And the problem with our churches today is that we come from the mission field and we come into the temple and we say to the unsaved, come on into the temple, and when you come in and you look like us and you act like us and you're worthy to be with us, then you too will get born again. But the church is supposed to be here where we meet with Daddy, we get filled with the Holy Spirit, we get the Word of God that fills us, and we get into the streets and we talk about the goodness of our God. I know that there's evangelists, I know that those that will go out and preach the gospel, but each and every one of us sits beside somebody in work. We have a we have our friends, we have our family, whoever we meet in this world. I want to put that burden back in your heart and my heart again, that whoever we meet every single day, that we would use the name of Jesus and declare the greatness and the goodness of our God and bring light to a sick world. And that's Acts chapter 2. It says that he added to the church daily. He added in chapter 6 and verse 7. And the word of God continued to increase. There's a good principle. The word of God continued to increase. And it says, and the number of disciples, now the word changes, it says, it multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. In other words, in Acts chapter 2, they began to speak to people and the Lord was adding to the church. But now we get to Acts chapter 6 and he's beginning to multiply. But not just multiply believers. The word says he multiplies disciples. Disciples is something more. A disciple means a disciplined follower or someone who says, I've heard the word, I've received the word, it's changed my life, now I'm going out to tell others that what God has done for me, he can also do for them. Amen. And when the church begins to stand together and go out together and everyone taking their responsibility, we move from a place of adding, beginning to come to a place of multiplying. Amen. And so in Acts chapter 5, I want you to see here in verse 42, Acts 5, 42, and every day in the temple from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching that Christ is Jesus. In other words, they just talked about God. They went everywhere and began to speak about him. You think, well, yeah, Neil, that's all lovely, and that's a different time, and, you know, they didn't have all these distractions in life. I want to show you what they did as a result of that. This one verse here in Acts chapter 19 and verse 10. Let's think about the times they're in. Are there mobile phones? No. There's no radio. There's no TV. There's no satellites. There's no internet. There's no cars. There's no bicycles. There's no planes. There's no trains. They are living in a difficult time. And in Acts chapter 19, verse 10, it says, this they continued for 2 years so that all of the residents of Asia heard the word of the Lord. You could skip past that in your Bible quickly and think, well, there you go, very good. It took them 2 years. But these are men that when you wanted to go to the next village, you had to walk by foot. The Asia Minor, I don't know how big it was or how many people, but this is a whole nations and continent. These men and women, they took it upon themselves to get up off their posteriums and go and speak to the word of God and begin to declare the goodness. And everyone who heard the word of God, they got excited. And it wasn't just the pastor. It wasn't just the elders. But every single person said, now, I've heard it. I've got excited about what God's doing. I'm joining in this race, and I'm beginning to share. And it was like a ripple effect that began to go, and it began to spread out. And Paul says in Colossians 1 and 6, I'll not say it, turn to this morning for time, but Colossians 1 and 6, Paul's speaking to the church, and he says, though you heard the gospel, and it came to you, but it not only came to you, it's coming to the whole world. And it says, and it's going forth, and it's bearing fruit, and it's increasing. That is the message of God this morning, that the gospel cannot be contained, and it is going forward, and it will bear fruit. What is the fruit? Souls will be saved in the name of Jesus. What is another fruit? That those that are sick will be sick no longer. Those that are in situations and bondage, the chains will be broken off them, and they will be set free. Now let me ask you a very simple question this morning. Were the early church more saved than you are? No. Were the early church more anointed than you are? No. Did the early church have more Holy Spirit than you had? No. Did the early church have more revelation than you had? No. The early church had nothing more than you had. In fact, we're even better because we've got the internet, we've got the phones, we've got the planes. If they could go and change a world in 2 years when they were limited with the resources that they had, then what can a believing church nowadays not do? Amen? That's what the Word of God says, that when He sends forth His Word, it'll not return unto Him void. Let me remind you that 2,000 years ago, heaven left heaven. God left heaven and He stepped down into this world. He put His foot down in the form of Jesus Christ, and the Word of God was sent forth into this world. Jesus physically left, but the Holy Spirit came, and the Holy Spirit is still here. His Word has been sent forth, and it will not return unto God void, but it will accomplish everything that it was sent to do. And you and I can join the race. You and I can join that Word and begin to go forth and declare the goodness of God and begin to change a nation. Not a pie-eyed dream, not a thing, but this will happen, amen, because it is the will of God. It will happen, and we have the privilege and the honor to join the race, to be a tool in the Master's hand and begin to get involved in the ministry. Not leaving it to the pastors, not leaving it to the elders, but every single person that's sitting here this morning getting involved. Now I'm going to read two verses and we're going to finish up. So I want you to turn with me to Acts chapter 1. Every day I've got a Bible reading, so as I get through the Bible once, you know, a couple of times a year. And so I'm going through that, and that means you're reading quite quickly. So I do that in the morning. But in the afternoon then I read the Bible, and I read it real slow. I try to imagine what's happening. I try to think of the situation, where they are. I just want to understand the Word very clearly. And there are many times that we read the Word and we go through it so quickly, we miss what it begins to say. And I want to show you something I've seen this week. It's Acts chapter 1. And Jesus is talking to the disciples, and He's about to be lifted up into heaven. And so He's giving them some final words. And so Acts chapter 1 and verse 6, and it's the disciples that are speaking. And so when they had come together, that's the disciples, they asked Him, "Lord, will You at this time restore the kingdom of Israel?" Jesus has risen from the dead. The disciples are excited now, and they're like, this must be the time now where You're going to restore Israel. Israel's going to be rebuilt. Fantastic. They thought that Jesus was risen from the dead. He was going to still do the work. He was the one that was going to change the world. It was still all on Him. And Jesus then, verse 7, and Jesus says to them, "It's not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by His own authority." And verse 8, "But you," who's you? The disciples in this instance. "But disciples, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you." When are the disciples going to receive that power? When the Holy Spirit comes inside of them. Why were the disciples then going to receive the Holy Spirit? Why were they getting the Holy Spirit? Were they getting it just so as they could have peace? Well, peace is a part. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit, He comes, He's the Comforter, He brings that peace. Was the Holy Spirit coming just so that they could speak in tongues? We see it that the minute the Holy Spirit comes, they did speak with new tongues. Was the Holy Spirit coming so that it could be anointed? Of course they're going to be anointed through the Holy Spirit. But what does Jesus say to them why the Holy Spirit is going to fall upon them? In verse 8 it says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and," or as a direct result of having the Holy Spirit, "you will be My witnesses in Jerusalem." In other words, Jesus said, your mission, your goal, the mandate that I pass over to you is that I have finished My race. I have run the course. I've declared that it's finished, and I've passed the baton over to you. And now you run the race, and you be My witnesses. You go into the streets, and you begin to declare the finished works of God and what I've done. And you don't need to do it in your own strength, in your own wisdom, in your own ways. You can now do this because the Holy Spirit is upon you. Amen. I'm not going to turn it this morning, but read Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, it says, the day of Pentecost had fully come, and then they were all gathered in the upper room, and then the Holy Spirit came in suddenly like a mighty rushing wind, and the fire fell upon their tongues, and then they began to speak in tongues. I wish I was in that room. And what would have happened if we're in that room? We're all filled with the Holy Spirit. And imagine that not one of us would have wanted to leave that room. God has come in. The Holy Spirit's there. It's an amazing experience. God is in this place. How could I ever leave this? But they were prompted by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has fallen. You are anointed now. You've got it inside of you. Now get out of that upper room. Don't sit here trying to get fat in the presence of God. Excuse me. And take everything from yourself. Get out of that upper room and go preach. And Peter, the one who was doing crazy things, he was the one that's then anointed. He goes out. He preaches the word of God. And what happens when the first sermon is preached? The first sermon is declared by Peter, and not one, not two, not three, but 3,000 people are born again as a result of the first statement. Jesus said to them, the Holy Spirit will fall on you, then go be my witness. What did they do? The Holy Spirit fell in the upper room. They got out and they went and declared, and they began to change a world. And you and I have the Holy Spirit upon us. Not a different Holy Spirit. We receive the same Holy Spirit. We receive the same measure of the Holy Spirit. Peter wasn't more anointed than you. Each and every one of us in this room have that same anointing, and we can go into this world and begin to change it. Now, my final verse this morning, Mark chapter 16. We all know what this verse is, the Great Commission. In Mark chapter 16, and Jesus is speaking. And says, verse 14, and afterward he appeared to the 11 themselves as they were reclining at the table. And he rebuked them for their unbelief and their hardness of heart, because they had not believed those who saw him after he had risen. And then what does Jesus say? And verse 15, and he said to them, now a bit of a simple school lesson here, who is speaking? Jesus is speaking. Who's he speaking to? He's talking to the disciples. So he says to them, disciples, go you into the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. He says, disciples, get up, you go and preach the gospel. Don't preach your message, don't preach your words, but preach what I have told you, the gospel, the good news, the full gospel of what Jesus done, and preach it in the whole world to everyone. Don't decide I'm going to preach to this person or that person. It says, wherever you go, preach the gospel to them. Then verse 16, whosoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Now let me ask you, who is he now speaking about? It says, whoever that believes is baptized shall be saved. We've got Jesus, he spoke to the disciples, and now he's given us two categories of people. He says, those who believe and those who don't believe. Whoever believes is baptized will be saved. Whoever does not believe will be condemned. So I've got to make you walk here slowly. I've got Jesus. He's speaking to the disciples. He tells them to go. He then says you're going to meet people, and they will become two categories. There'll be those who believe, and there'll be those who don't believe. Amen? Straightforward and simple. Verse 17 then says, and these signs will accompany those who, what? Believe. Four people, Jesus, disciples, those who believe, those who don't believe. Now, let's read it again in verse 17. And the signs will follow who? The signs will follow not Jesus. The signs will follow not the disciples, but these signs will follow which category? Those who believe. Which category do you fall into this morning? Are you Jesus? No. Were you one of the 12 disciples? No. Let me help you now. The answer to the next question is going to be right. Are you one of those who believe? Yes. So now I know the category I'm in. I am in the category that says that I believe in Jesus and I believe his word. Well then, let's see what the word of God says that's going to happen in your life, and it's promised to you. And these signs, verse 17, and these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name they will what? Cast out demons. Amen. How many want to do that? They'll cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents, no thank you, with their hands, and they will drink any deadly poison, and it will not hurt them. And look at this, and they will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. Amen. There's a good revelation this morning that if you believe in Jesus, if you are filled with the Holy Spirit, then you can go out in the confidence of what the Word of God says, that it promises you that signs and wonders will follow you. In the name of Jesus, it says that you will cast out demons, you'll speak with new tongues, and you will lay hands on the sick, and they might recover. No, nobody will recover. No, it says, and they shall recover. Amen. And that is the promise to us. Now, let's see what else it doesn't say. It doesn't say, and now these signs will follow those who believe, who have been a Christian for 14 years, who've studied the Bible, who've gone to Bible school, who have been under Pastor Joe for 18 years. It doesn't set any category at all. It says the minute that you are born again, you believe in Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes into your life, you are already fully anointed. This has got nothing to do with you. It is God who works through you. It's inside of you. Your job is just to go, God, ain't got nothing to do with me. I believe you. I believe your word. Your word says that I lay hands on the sick and recover. So I'm going to trust your word and go out and lay hands on the sick and see them recover. Amen? Amen. And so I just want to finish with this final thought. That before a lady gives birth, there's something that has to happen. You have to get pregnant. I don't know any lady that hasn't given birth without first getting pregnant. So you have to get pregnant, and you have to have, and we call that period the expecting period. You haven't got the baby. You're not holding the baby in your hands yet, but there's something happened. It's a period of expectation, a period where that's all you begin to think about. You begin to dream that you've got the baby. You're buying the clothes. You're preparing the room. You're getting everything ready for that. And that is the place that in this church that we're at in this season, that we are in a season of expectation. That I believe wholeheartedly that God is going to come in and flood this place again like he did several years ago. That he is going to begin to increase the faith levels. He can't give us more faith because he's already given us faith. But he's going to switch it on inside of us. That this is going to be a church that begins to expect that we will see God move every single time. Not, I wonder, will God move? I wonder, can God move? I wonder if it's God's will to move. No, a church that says God will always move. We will always see healing. We'll always see deliverance. And it may take a period of time until we see it in the natural. But we will stand firm and resolute until we see it come to pass. Let's just say this then. This morning, we are all pregnant this morning, and some of you can receive that as a word if you need it, but we're pregnant this morning, pregnant with gain, where the Holy Spirit is bubbling inside of us. This is a church that's going to wake out of apathy and begin to be filled with the presence of God, that's going to begin to make a change in this community, because it's the will of God to begin to move in Craigavon. I declare it this morning that Craigavon will be saved in the name of Jesus. I declare that the people in this region and in this area, they will be healed in their bodies in the name of Jesus. We will no longer hide our candle under a bushel. We will no longer be happy and content to sit in the shadows, but we will burn for him. The Word of God says, arise and shine. Amen. Arise and shine, for the glory of the Lord is upon you. Amen. Let's just stand then this morning as we get ready to close. I'm going to pray over you. I want to just grab the hand of the person beside you. I want to bring to your attention, not to glorify sickness, but I want to bring to your attention that's young Hannah. And Hannah, I'm not going to go into all the details, but over the last few days, she was fainting. She had vomiting up blood. She's had initial tests. There was ulcers. Things had stopped, but the vomiting of blood has continued. And so that shouldn't be, amen. She's a daughter of God. That shouldn't be. So I want us to stand together and believe and claim that victory for Hannah. And as I continue to pray for that, I also want you to think of a loved one yourself. We can't preach a word of God that says that God is well able and we believe this gospel and then not have signs and wonders. So I believe that we will have this victory in the name of Jesus because we already have it. And so, Lord, we just come into your presence this morning. We come not begging and we come not pleading, but I come in the confidence of your word. Lord, your word says that if we come and we believe your word, then we know that we have your attention. And if we have your attention, Lord, then we know that if we pray according to your word that you hear us. And if you hear us, then we have the petitions of our heart. So, Lord, I bring young Hannah before you in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father God, that this has not taken you by surprise. You are not shocked by this sickness. For, Father God, you are our healer. You are our deliverer. So I stand and declare, by Jesus' stripe, Hannah is healed in the name of Jesus. I speak to those ulcers in the name of Jesus. You will be healed and you will go in the name of Jesus. Any perforation, any acidic tack inside of that stomach, I command it to be healed in the name of Jesus, for everything to be restored to normal. I cause the acid levels to be restored in the name of Jesus. All of that blood that is in the stomach, I command it to pass out now in the name of Jesus and not to return. I declare total health in the name of Jesus. I speak to the spirit of fear that is over her life right now. Spirit of fear, get off in the name of Jesus. You do not have a right to be there. The word of God declares that you have not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. I declare the peace of God that passeth all understanding to be upon Hannah and all of the family now in Jesus' name. And Father God, we stand in the gap for every person here this morning, whether it be for them or for a loved one. I thank you, Father God, according to your word, we are healed this morning in the name of Jesus. We stand in a place of authority and a place of victory, not trying to receive it, but a place of thanking you already that we have it. We stand in confidence and in faith of your word this morning that we are healed, we're delivered, and we're set free. I speak to every sickness and every disease that wrecks and ruins. Get off the bodies, get off the mind in the name of Jesus. Those that are tormented in their mind, I declare the peace of God over you now in the name of Jesus. Every stronghold that is built up, I tear you down in the name of Jesus. In the precious name of Jesus, I speak to the enemy and I declare you that you are bound and you are kicked out. You are defeated. You have no right to return in the name of Jesus. Father God, I thank you. I give you praise. I give you glory and the honor for everything that's been done. I thank you already in advance for what's been accomplished here today. You are an awesome God, and you are a mighty God, and we celebrate you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Be blessed, and we see you tonight at 6:30.
Before the light.